Welcome to First Post Game Plan. We have with us Ayaz Memon, Cricketwallah, to discuss the year in sport that has been. And today we have to discuss the biggest event of this
special
year.
Focus on the Olympics.
Rio Olympics 2016. You know, Olympics years are always special. Especially, you know, as an Indian fan, you're always looking forward. And with the kind of performance we had in London, 6 medals, I remember there being a lot of hope, a lot of expectation.
Yes.
What happened was, of course, we ended up with 2 medals. Sakshi Malik and P V Sindhu.
And so belatedly, it almost came
after,
you know,
almost
a huge
relief. 10 days, I believe.
Yes, after 10 or 11, on the 11th day, we got the first medal, and there was a lot of breast beating and, you know, lamenting and whatever else happened. Look, if you ask me, when you look back now at the Olympics, you have to express disappointment at India's performance.
Right.
I mean, we all got swayed and got excited by the victories of Sakshi and P V Sindhu, and of course also Deepak Karmakar, who put up a sterling show.
Absolutely.
in a discipline where nobody expected an Indian to even get into the finals. But when you look back, Xenia, I think, you know, on the basis of our London performance, we were looking at 10 to 11 medals all told. And 2 is a real big climb down. And the areas in which we really suffered, shooting, archery, apart from tennis, I think we should have got a medal in tennis. And perhaps even in wrestling in the men's section, boxing. These were all disciplines where we were expected to get some medals, and it was actually very, I mean, the redemption came through these 2 girls, Sindhu and Sakshi Malik. Otherwise, it would have been a wipeout, a zero, a cipher for India.
Absolutely. You know, when you say that expectation, well, this was the largest contingent, right? 100 plus athletes going, there were 12 shooters, and a lot of them were world champions. So the expectation was not unfounded.
Not unfounded. And actually, look, they did well to qualify. So what it shows is that the pyramid base has expanded, you know, of athletes who can be called elite athletes, or, you know, able to compete at the Olympic level or qualified to compete at the Olympic level. And therefore, what's not happening, why aren't we getting the medals, is really the crux issue that the Indian sports administrators and federation will have to address going ahead. Was this just one of those years where things didn't go right, or is this slightly more or something more seriously problematic? Like, for instance, at that level, there's very little to choose between athletes. The champions are defined by their, you know, how they perform in crunch situations.
That little inch of
the
margin.
The last mile, as they say. You know, you have to do well in the last mile. I mean, even Sindhu versus Carolina Marin, we saw how, you know, she became the champion. Sindhu played superbly. Nobody expected her to reach this level. But having said that, Marin showed why she is the champion and why she is the number one.
That absolutely. In fact, one thing, as you said, you know, that little inch, a constant through these performances were these fourth place finishes, so to say. There was Abhinav Bindra, who missed bronze by a whisker.
Yes.
Deepa, although admirable to even reach that fourth position, 0.05 points. Sania Mirza, Rohan Bopanna, who lost the bronze medal match.
Correct.
Atanu Das, the archer, even the hockey team reaching up to the quarterfinals.
Correct.
So that little slip between the cup and the lip, so to say, was not so little for us.
So it makes a big difference. It's called the, in the old days, it used to be called the killer instinct. I don't particularly like that phrase. But it's to make that leap to go and be on the podium or not, you know. A lot of athletes are happy just being in the Olympics. I think India needs to move ahead from there. We've always had athletes who gone to the Olympics. Now we need winners. I think that's the national sentiment. That's the aspiration of the people and the athletes. I'm not saying that they're not aspiring to be medal winners. But if there is, maybe sports psychology needs to be kind of, you know, influence or increase more in the curriculum for these athletes when they are training. Because a lot of it, or almost entirely, it has to do with the mind. It's not to do with the physical effort. Ultimately, even if Sindhu is playing Carolina Marin, she's still playing those 3 games. She's not playing 1.5 games and saying, I'm off. And what's happening in the 3rd game, perhaps, is the mental leap that you have to take. Leap of faith, or, you know, show the spunk, or the resourcefulness, or the wherewithal. And she's young. She's 22, and she's probably going to be, you know, get better. But I'm saying these are the issues that are going to, which the Indian sports authorities have to address.
Right. So I think, yes, mental toughness, that final, that killer instinct, let's call it, that's something to...
I just want to add a little bit about hockey. I think we actually did very well, considering where we were.
Yes, we there were times that we didn't qualify for the Olympics. And from that
and
to...
It's not only good from India's point of view that we are doing well in hockey, because there's a very strong emotional bond with the sport, but it's also good for the sport. Because without India, hockey is going to languish. So India doing well brings in the eyeballs, hopefully it will bring in the money, it will make the sport more visible and it will get more fans and so on and so forth, and it becomes a formidable sport again as it used to be in this, you know, right from the 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s.
Till I think the last medal was Moscow in 1980.
Correct.
In fact, you know, it's interesting you mentioned hockey, because this has been a fantastic year for the hockey team in general.
Yes.
The Champions Trophy silver, Sultan Azlan Shah silver, Asian Champions Trophy.
So Coach Ottman is doing something right.
And which means that the pool is there, the talented pool of players
that
is
really
there.
That is the crux. So where does the coach come in? At the end of the day, it's not about just showing them dribbling skills. It's about strategizing and picking out the right players and making the right combination. In games like football and hockey, this becomes more important. He's not imparting necessarily skills, you know. Or even in cricket, Anil Kumble is not teaching Virat Kohli how to bat. But his job is to get the right combo going, along in consultation with the captain. There it's more deliberated, there's more confabulation. In hockey and football, it's all a priori, is determined before the match takes place or a tournament takes place.
Right, and I think yes, Ottman has definitely contributed to that. But from all the misses, you know, we must talk a little bit more about our hits. Sakshi Malik's bout especially, I remember it was the 12th day and, you know, she lost then, but in her wrestling bout. And you're like, okay, maybe this is done, especially after Vinesh Phogat's injury. But then due to rapid charge, she comes back.
Yeah.
She
and in the nick
goes
of time,
on to win. Exactly.
You know, I mean, even in rapid charge, she may have lost, but for
that, and she was
points.
Down for the longest
she
time
the
before
longest
she...
Time. So I had a, you know, at a literature festival, I had an interactive session with her.
Right.
Yeah. So she's a very pleasant young girl. Obviously, she's the star now. But when they went to the Rio Olympics, she was not the star. The stars were the Phogat sisters.
Absolutely.
Now,
right.
Even bigger
now,
stars because of Dangal.
Yeah, popularly known as the Dangal sisters.
Dangal
now.
Sisters, yeah. But Sakshi, I think she is very, you know, she's very determined. When you speak to her, you realize how clear in her mind she is about what she wants to achieve. And now, having tasted blood, so to speak, she wants to do even better. And she's pint-sized, but she's full of, you know, verve and full of ambition. I think that's... And in her case too, she's got a lot of support from her parents. She's also from Haryana.
Yeah.
She's faced the same hardships that you would see in Dangal with the Phogat sisters. So, you know, the socio-cultural restraints or constraints which are there, which she also had to overcome. Support from the family being paramount. And then she's gone on to, ultimately, she's won a medal. And you cannot take that away from her. She's the first woman wrestler to win an Olympic medal.
And I think that is, you know.
It's awesome.
Absolutely. And to, you know, the whole aspect of gender and then the sport of wrestling.
Yes.
Because as you said, there were so many obstacles to overcome, not just your opposition, right?
Yes, look at her.
Absolutely. And the joy you could see, you know, I had a interaction with her and I remember her being as the most cheerful athlete
yes.
I have ever seen.
Yes.
Completely. And I think this shows that again, the young talent in India, definitely they're just the right direction.
And what I liked about her and Sindhu, who we'll watch, is the way they've soaked in the stardom and the accolade that have come. You know, when I spoke to her before the interactive session and post that, there's no false modesty about her. She knows what she's achieved. She's enjoying the attention. But she's not kind of taken up by it, consumed by it and putting on airs. And I think that's a very good sign, because you can get, you know, you can lose your way when you're 22, 23
right.
and the world is your oyster suddenly. And then everybody is throwing, you know, riches at
yeah,
you.
Rewards and...
Yeah, and the attention. It's not just the money, it's also the fame. It can kind of take your mind away from your main task, but not for her. And I don't think it's also... Or for Sindhu. I think Sindhu is also very level-headed.
Absolutely, because P V Sindhu, you know, after she has soaked in all the adulation of a silver, she goes ahead and wins her first Super Series title in China.
Absolutely.
She's qualified for Dubai Super Series final. She reaches the final of Hong Kong. So you've seen how Sindhu's game has steadily improved. And while credit to Gopi Chand, it also shows that yes, Indian badminton she made a name. First silver by a woman though.
Fantastic. Look, I did commentary in the inaugural Premier Badminton League in the time 2013, 3 years back. She was still a very gawky teenager, you know, all arms and legs, very gangly. Now she is, of course, strong, composed, a woman, and playing extremely well. And the progress she's made has been fantastic, you know. I think there is a very good crop of badminton players who emerged in India, and thanks largely to
the Gopi Chand Academy,
the Prakash Padukone Academy. But Gopi's been virtually in charge of steering the Indian talent in tournaments like the Olympics and stuff. No medals for Gopi, unfortunately, but he's deserving of one. But she has made a quantum jump, technically as well as temperamentally. There was a time in 2013 in the Premier Badminton League where I felt that, you know, like I mentioned, we talked about earlier, the mental toughness, right. She would lose a crunch point rather than win it. Though she was very talented in her age group, but when you're 19, 20, you're playing somebody who may be 25, 26 and has got 6, 7 years of experience, you still have to beat that person.
Right.
So now she's acquired that confidence and the mental toughness to take on the best. Today, international badminton players, whether they're from China or Indonesia or Malaysia, the strong countries, Koreas, they are wary of Sindhu. They see her as the most serious challenger to their kind of hegemony which was there. And that, I think, is the big you know, progress that she's made.
Right. In fact, I think the podium did not have a Chinese player.
It didn't have a Chinese player.
The badminton podium at Rio Olympics. And it shows, yes, that the sport is definitely opening up. And Gopi Chand is right at the forefront, making sure that India will have its mark.
Again, like, I think badminton is thriving today because of China and India.
Absolutely.
The number of eyeballs that there are is half the world.
So and they're producing the players to match it.
That's why you get the eyeballs. Because if your players don't produce results, then people switch off. Today, at the switch of a remote, you can go from any one sports channel to another, one sports to another. So you need consistently to have winners. The sports revolution in India, apart from whatever else needs to be done at the grassroots level, coaching, sports medicine, etc., also needs to produce champions and produce heroes and, you know, stars. Because that's where people will come and watch. And if they come and watch, then the sport thrives.
Right, I think there's one sport that a lot of Indians discovered or probably watched live for the first time this Olympics, artistic gymnastics.
Yes.
A lot of us in India might not have even heard that it's an Olympic sport. And here we have an Indian qualifying for the final. Deepa Karmakar, while she came fourth, I think would have probably one of the
biggest success stories. For the most time, including, I think, me certainly, but including, we all thought she was from Maharashtra. Deepa Karmakar.
She's a Tripura girl.
And again, a terrific story. The way she's come up, the way she's trained, almost in isolation with serious hardship, no infrastructure, no incentive in a sense. And there she is. And the measure of confidence, what I liked about all these three, Deepa didn't win a medal, but Sindhu and Sakshi and Deepa, is the enormous self-confidence that they've had. And I think it's been a breakthrough year for women in sport in India. And the fact that they will inspire so many young girls to take up sports and inspire parents to put their girls into sports.
Absolutely. In fact, I remember Deepa Karmakar, a couple of interviews she's spoken about how everybody was, in fact, they asked her, what is this? Is it like a circus?
Yes.
I remember her saying that her training was made by rejects from the Commonwealth Games in Delhi. So if she could reach so far with that infrastructure,
yes.
Just imagine now with the national consciousness.
She even trained on a scooter, didn't she?
Yes. Sort of a makeshift, absolutely.
Amazing, extraordinary.
Well, let's see, you know, these three women.
The only thing she couldn't accommodate, poor thing, is a BMW car that she got. So she had to give it back.
Well, hopefully that also translates to more training infrastructure for her.
No infrastructure for a BMW car in Tripura.
Right, but these were the stars. Yeah. I mean, there were a couple of flops for India too. We've spoken about all these fourth places, etc. The shooting flops and obviously the mental disintegration. But, you know, what next then? For these players themselves.
So it's a conundrum, Dina. So in amongst the archers, the shooters, and a lot of the boxers also, or at least some of the boxers, they've done extremely well in events outside of the Olympics, in World Championships, Asians, Commonwealth, etc., etc. Why can't they replicate? So either it's stage fright. The Olympics is the biggest event. It just happens to the best. It can happen to anybody. But that's where the challenge. That's what I mentioned. That now. More and more, I'm convinced that in the Indian sporting arena, a lot more emphasis needs to be paid to sports psychology, because that's what makes champions. And a lot of the elite athletes that you see, not just the tennis players, have their own sports psychologists or independent coaches. Because five fingers are not the same. When you reach that level, you need personal attention, personal motivation, and stuff like that. And I think we are now becoming more and more resource driven. So we are not saying, okay, we've got a clutch of 20 girls, let's put them in Sai or Patiala or wherever, and whoever ends up winning, good luck otherwise. No, I think there is CSR activities from corporate sector. The government is picking out elite athletes and saying, we can fund you 50, 60, 70 athletes who get.
And the top scheme is one of them.
There is Olympic Gold Quest, which supports, you know, talented athletes and so on. Go Sports. There are several things that have come up which, to me, suggest that there is a huge interest outside of even the sports administrators wanting to give Indian sports a push. But I think the crucial aspect, again, and I want to just reiterate that, is mental toughness, the psychological factor which will separate the also-ran from the champion.
Right, I think that will be the biggest takeaway for us from the 2016 Olympics, apart from the medals. And you know, one more thing, while not the Olympics game, the Paralympic games that followed soon after, well, they were really good for India, for the want of a better phrase. They were fantastic.
I did a session with them also.
All right, and with Mariappan, Deepa Malik.
And, you know, so, again, all are very inspiring stories because they obviously have, you know,
they've had a different set of hardships.
They've had different challenges, you know, and everybody loses sight of the Paralympics, not just in India, but across the world, because it comes almost immediately after the Olympics. And by that time, everybody seems to be spent. After the Olympics is over, the attention moves to other sports or to other things, and nobody pays so much attention. And in the past, we haven't done well, let's be honest. This time, you suddenly have
four
medal winners. So I think that's got a boost. Again, it shows to me, it's not just about the fact that they've been doing well in the Paralympics and won medals. It's the aspiration of a certain age group, and, you know, young. They are slightly older than your Olympic athletes, you know.
Except Mariappan, who was a teenager,
So, but Deepa Malik is obviously much older. But what a story. It's a saga. You know, it's something that, in my opinion, deserves a film also.
A biopic worthy one.
But it just shows that there is a Josh in India which says, I'm not there just to participate in sport any longer, I want to go out there and win. And I think that's the big leap, irrespective of whether we won many medals or not. I would like to believe that that's a big leap that we've taken.
And that is the biggest positive
positive.
And you know, as before we end, while we're talking about the positives from Olympics and Paralympics, there's a bit of a blip towards the end of the year with the whole Suresh Kalmadi being given IOA presidentship, turning into this massive controversy.
It's not a blip, it might end up becoming a stinking controversy.
It certainly has the makings of one. Now, we all know what happened with the Commonwealth Games, and while, you know, allegations flew all the way, I think this is going to be a sort of a roadblock with the kind of Indian the sports administration upheaval that people are looking for.
It's a little confounding to me. See, IOA has chosen, these are allegations against them, so either they are convinced that there's nothing, you know, nothing to charge them with, or it won't stand the test of legal scrutiny or whatever. If they are so convinced, then they could have waited, got themselves cleared, and the IOA could have waited till they got cleared, and then there is nobody who can stop them. Or there seems to be a challenge from the IOA within to the sports ministry.
Right.
And in a sense, the government. And there's some politics also at play, because Suresh Kalmadi was from the Congress, the sports minister is from the BJP.
Right.
I mean, it's a bit of a, you know, I don't know, it's a cauldron there, and all kinds of things are brewing. One doesn't know exactly what is happening. But clearly, there seems to be, you know, let's see what you can do kind of a situation.
And I think that might just mar what has been a really good year for Indian sport.
I won't say a decent year. I won't say a spectacular year.
Absolutely,
certainly
not.
Spectacular year in cricket, but not in
other sports.
We've had an extremely good year in badminton and in women's wrestling. In other sports, not such a great year. But again, as I mentioned, let's go back to the original thing which we talked about. Maximum number of athletes qualifying for the Olympics. No fudging there. Good qualification marks getting there. Not all of them delivering. That's the issue. And therefore,
right. So while we take the big positive
the mental toughness
of the two medals, we also have to focus on the biggest takeaway that while we have a good base, they need to be given that sort of infrastructure and support. Well, hopefully the coming year will be better. While no Olympics, maybe we can get a couple of medals at World Championships.
And build from there for the next Olympics.
Absolutely.
You know, four years.
Tokyo 2020 should be the target.
Yes, absolutely.
And on that note, I think, thanks, Ayaz. It has been wonderful discussing
Thank
the Olympics
you,
as
Nina.
Usual.
Yes.
And thanks to all our viewers for tuning in.